Okay, so, hello people, what is up? I am Dracodan, and today I'm going to be doing Sparkster on SNES for you. I'm going to be doing normal mode, so I've been told that I'm just good to go, so without further ado, I'm going to give a countdown of 3, 2, 1, go. So, Sparkster is part of the Rocket Knight series. A lot of people have heard of the Genesis game Rocket Knight Adventures. This is a spin-off slash sequel to it, which features a lot of the same mechanics, such as the titular Rocket Boost mechanic. This is the main way that we move through this game. And an addition to this game, as opposed to either of the Genesis games, is the use of the rolling attack, which you can see here. This is going to be my main form of attack throughout the game, as well as the Rocket Boost. The rolling attack is very useful when I can't Rocket Boost to move along the ground, though I can't abuse it as much as possible, as this game has a hidden meter called Exhaustion, which fills up as I use the rolling attack and reaches 100%-ish after 6 rolling attacks in a row. And when that happens, I just lose control of Sparkster for about 3 seconds, which wastes a lot of time, obviously. Exhaustion drains when you either take damage, that completely resets the meter, or alternatively, it drains over time, or when I hit the ground after... Ooh, that was a bit hairy. So basically, I can't go crazy with rolling attacks at all times, and I need to moderate when I use them. So we've already reached the first boss. As you can see, this is a game that moves extremely quickly. And I'm just going to be using rocket boosts to dispatch this boss, and rolling attacks to dodge when his eye laser is going to trigger. And once we get into stage 2, you will see that rolling attack management is very important in the spots that I use it, to make sure that I can go as fast as reasonably possible whilst not triggering exhaustion, like I'm saying. What you may have also noticed through stage 1 is that lag management is extremely important in this game. This is a game that experiences a lot of lag spikes when there's a lot of activity going on, and lag naturally can translate to input drops as well. This is especially apparent during boss fights or spots of the game where there's a lot of action going on. So a big part of learning to run this game well is learning how to minimize lag, since that makes the game faster, obviously, and also to deal with the input drops that come as a result of it. See, there's exhaustion. I don't know why I did that, because I knew that was coming, that in that particular spot I couldn't afford 4 rolling attacks, but I apparently did it anyway, because I'm apparently bad at this game. So, movement in this game is very much momentum-oriented, specifically transferring momentum between Sparkster's various states. Now, whilst he's boosting, that's known as the boost state, and then when he comes out of a boost, he enters that helpless animation, which I just call the helpless state. Most runners previously used to immediately rolling attack after they left the boost state, which isn't actually the best way to move, because after you leave the boost state and enter the helpless state, you still carry through the momentum from the boost, especially if you're airborne. So I only start rolling after that acceleration has decayed back down to a normal level. Also, this is good RNG. Yep, that was good RNG on that boss. Bosses in this game are extremely RNG heavy, in that they have very random attack patterns, and there's not really much way to control the attack patterns they give you. Some of them, like this boss, it's only an annoyance if they use the wrong attacks. Other bosses will just flat out kill you if they use the wrong attacks, and it's very difficult to deal with it. Now, coming up in stage 3 is an auto-scroller. Specifically, once the stage starts, there is 73 seconds of auto-scroller, in which it's better for me to do absolutely nothing, because attacking things just causes more enemies to spawn and can potentially cause lag. So, I'm going to take this opportunity to give a short announcement. So, coming up later in the marathon, tomorrow I think, is a race of Sonic Adventure 2 Battle Hero Story between Ford373 and Lilac Ramboob. It is my primary speed game, and it's a really great speed game, which I encourage anyone to try if they want. But a fairly important announcement, since it is at this point getting to be a very optimized speed game. And it's a very challenging speedrun as well. Like, it's a really hard speedrun. It's one of the hardest runs out there, I would say. So playing at the top level, it's like people are really struggling to improve the game any further. But despite that, today we saw a 10-second Hero Story world record by a mustache, who has long been one of the best runners of the game, but recently took a several-month break to play Overwatch. And now he's occasionally coming back to do occasional runs of the game, and today, after a race that happened in a different marathon, Sunshine for V-Man, he just went ahead and set a 10-second world record, which is incredible. So, yeah, congratulations must be given to him. And now we get to the part of the stage that we actually play. So we get to this mini-boss, and there's also damage management in this game. We have various ways of dealing damage in the game. I have the sword, which can use the sword strike itself and a projectile, and then I have the rolling attack and the rocket boost. The sword projectile deals 3 damage, the sword strike deals 4 damage, the rolling attack deals 5 damage, and the rocket boost deals 6 damage. And all enemies, as you would expect, have a specific amount of HP. But this translates to, on certain enemies, if I use a specific combo of attacks to increase damage output at certain points, I can kill them in, you know, one or two less attacks. For that mini-boss there, it didn't matter which attacks I used, since he dies in the same amount of hits if I use 5 rocket boosts and then another attack. But with the sword swipe, I can hit him sooner. Like, I can hit him a few frames sooner, as soon as his iframes run out, so it's a slight optimization to do it there. There's a couple of spots later in the run where I will be exploiting trying to use the right combination of attacks to decrease the number of hits it takes to kill something. It's actually especially apparent at the start of the next stage when we enter the laser corridor in the submarine, because the laser corridor, I need to destroy 3 laser doors that would normally be 4 hit, but with careful damage routing I can kill them in 3 hits each. So not only am I killing those enemies faster, but it's especially helpful because that section of the stage is one of the laggiest spots in the entire game, so any time that we can reduce the fight by is obviously very useful. Alright, I was being a little careful there, since I didn't want to outright die. At least, you don't want to die at the start of that boss. This is the only spot in the game where you have a mech that can attack independently of Sparkster. That robot ostrich, the Stampedo, can shoot energy rings. If I'm already dead, then I can use the Stampedo to finish off the boss, which actually interrupts the death animation and lets me still progress even though I'm dead. Which is very helpful, since this game, you may have noticed on the stage clear screen, it features a life bonus that ticks down. At the end of each stage, there is a stage clear bonus, and then there's a life bonus. I actually want to, for optimization's sake, finish each stage with as little health as possible, because then it reduces the length of time that the life bonus is on screen, which introduces a big element of risk and reward into the game. It's not a very minor time save to end with little health remaining, but it does add up. So this stage is going fairly well so far. Stage 4 is a very technical stage, so... Actually, never mind, this isn't going particularly well, actually. This is... Well, I mean, I say it's not going well. I'm only a couple of seconds behind where I should be, but I consider that, honestly, to be quite a major time loss in this game. Like, this game is experiencing, at this point, quite a high degree of optimization. I run all 3 major categories in this game, easy, normal, and hard. To put it into perspective, the easy world record is 1305, where my sum of best is 1257. So it features most of the stages that you're seeing here, which you can see they're really technical, fast-paced, and there's lots of potential for saving time. And my PB is like 7-8 seconds away from my sum of best, so it is quite optimized. It's the same sort of deal with this category here, where my PB is 1914, and sum of best is less than a minute away, I think. And there's a lot more randomness in this category as well, so it's quite difficult to handle. And I dispatched a boss in the meantime, without really explaining what was going on. Sorry about that. Most bosses in the game will follow that sort of pattern that I was doing there, though, where I'm trying to alternate rolling attacks and rocket boosts, since that's generally the most efficient way to deal damage. So now we come to stage 5, Golden Pyramid. This is one of my weaker stages in the game, although thankfully it's a very short stage, since we do a bit of a mini-skip here. This is meant to be a puzzle section where you get stuck in like a shifting maze, but since we know to just trigger that twice, we just immediately get to the mini-boss halfway through the stage. Really? I'm so bad at this new strat. That's me trying to minimize the number of hits it takes to beat him, but by using damage management, but I'm not very good at pulling off that strat yet. Alright, so there's another mini skip coming up here, which I do by jumping against this ceiling. I'm gonna wait for this next cycle. That was a very difficult trick to pull off before we worked out that you can indeed use a jump against the ceiling to give yourself the perfect position. Prior to that, it was just a matter of standing in the right spot, engaging when you were in the right spot. I also came very close to death there where that spike ceiling was, because I need to boost up through that corridor to get through. But if at any point you touch the spike ceiling, you just die, regardless of remaining health. Alright, that was a very good fight. That boss is extremely random and can do a lot of various things, including flying around and also digging into the ground. If he digs into the ground, that's an automatic 5-second time loss that I can do nothing about, so I'm very glad to have gotten a one cycle on that boss. That's really favourable RNG. That boss is also the only enemy in the game to feature different HP and damage mechanics than any other enemy in the game. Every other enemy in the game just has, you know, their static amount of HP, and you deal the amount of damage that a move deals to them. But for some reason, that boss only has 25 HP, and then all attacks that you deal to it only deal half the regular damage. I don't know why that is, but it's kind of weird. So hopefully I can use my movement strat here to miss these shrimps on these drums. Very clean. That was extremely good. It's really hard to get through that section quickly. And a difficult jump here. Got it. Nice. That's a lot tighter than it seems. If you miss a specific cue for getting that jump, you actually can't get that jump whilst you're still attached to the pipe, whatever it is you're actually attached to. Don't go too fast here or you get bounced off and fall into the tubers. I messed that up in my last marathon run. Yeah, I should mention that this is the second marathon run I've done of this game today. Because I was previously doing this game in Sunshine for V-Man, and now I'm doing it here for you guys. So hopefully I can do a slightly better job this time. Not that my first run today was a bad run, but it could have gone better because I made a couple of mistakes in various spots and then also died to the final boss because that thing's brutal. It's RNG hell. So is this boss. This is the stage 6 boss where there are 8 stages. Axel Gear is brutal. Because of attacks like that they can use. Come on, get in the corner. Oh, you... Okay. Alright, that was a very, very weird fight, but I also didn't really get to capitalize on a favorable AI pattern. So, as you can see, there's a few attacks that he uses there. The attack that I wanted to see, but I failed to capitalize on, is the kick attack, where he just kicks towards you. That deals a measly half a heart of damage, which is measly considering his most damaging attack is the fiery charge attack, which deals 2 hearts of damage. But if he kicks at you, not only does it deal very little damage, if you stand in the corner, it also gets him locked into the corner. And then I can just continually roll to the left into the corner and keep dealing hits to him whilst damage boosting through him, which is by far the most efficient way to deal damage to him. And since taking damage also resets your exhaustion, you can just keep on infinitely chaining rolling attacks and you won't actually get exhausted. Or if you do, he'll immediately damage you and knock you out of it. So that's by far the best way to deal with that fight if he gives you the right attack. But it's not very manipulable since the RNG seed for what his actions are going to be is set when you enter that screen. As in when you take the last portal. And then once the fight starts, the fight is also manipulated by all of your actions, like your position, your attacks, the inputs that you do, they all influence his actions. The upcoming boss of this stage is the worst part of this game, honestly, both casually and speedrun-wise. This is something that spoils the enjoyment of prospective speedrunners and casual players alike. Like, if you read casual reviews of this game, a thing that you're going to see a lot of is people saying, oh, this is a 10 out of 10 game, it's so awesome, it's so fun to play, except for this one boss in this stage, which is the worst possible experience. And they're not exactly wrong. It's a Rock'em Sock'em Robots duel in space, again against Axel Gear, who gets his own mech at the end of the stage. We also have our own mech, but a lot of people have thought for a long time that Axel's mech is a lot tougher and a lot stronger than ours because it kills you very quickly. But I did some task testing in this in like Memory Viewer and found some relevant memory values to suggest that his mech is actually no stronger than yours. It's actually identical to yours. Axel's mech has 224 HP, which is the same as your total HP value, and his punches also deal the same amount of damage that your punches do as well. A regular jab from one of the mech's arms deals 8 damage, which you can use quickly to keep him locked down, but instead, rather than chaining jabs together, what we want to do is use 1-2 punches, because I discovered that if you, say for example, miss a left jab and then quickly follow it up with a right punch, it becomes a right straight, which deals a base of 12 damage instead. But you can increase the damage even further by chaining it close to your first punch, which makes it a maximum of 20 damage. And then the damage tails off back towards 12 the longer the gap is between the two punches. So what I'm going to be doing is whiffing as many left punches as possible and then following it up with right punches immediately. And I'm going to try a bit of a positional manipulation to keep him locked into the corner as well. I'll hopefully be able to get 6 or 7 good hits in as the fight starts, which will knock him into phase 2, because this guy also has 3 distinct phases where he behaves differently, which is based on his remaining HP. And phase 2 starts at about 50% health. And in that phase, he will do some frequent charges towards me with his guard up, and then he'll take his guard down to take pot shots. I can take that opportunity to get a few more hits in, and if I deal enough damage fast enough, it'll knock him straight into phase 3 without letting him turtle up for a bit. And phase 3 is at about 20% health. 25% health, I should say. He enters an all-out desperate berserk rush where he just starts punching back and forth and doesn't let up until you're dead. That is what kills most people in this fight, because he's far more accurate at dealing hits than you are. So I'm going to concentrate for a bit, and hopefully we can... This is dangerous, but let's go Zen mode for a second. I'm just going to damage race him. Get wrecked, matey! Wow, that was dangerous. So, ironically, that's the fastest type of fight you can get, but it's also the most dangerous. That berserk rush, he can randomly... I say about the fight having 3 phases. Phase 1 is 100% to 50% HP. It's the most dangerous phase in the fight because he will randomly do whatever he wants. My idea for making this fight more consistent when I started testing that fight was to minimize the time that phase 1 takes by just immediately getting him into phase 2, because it reduces the chance of that random berserk rush happening. But then after some more testing of me just generally getting better at the fight, I discovered, hang on, a random berserk is actually, if you want to go fast, the best thing that can happen, because it fixes him in place more consistently, and then you can just deal damage more quickly. It's incredibly dangerous, but it is the fastest way to end the fight if you are good at handling it. So I'm glad that I didn't get punished there by just getting immediately killed by him. So this is the last stage of the game, stage 8. Very quick Weird Wolf fight. That's the only name I have for that boss, Weird Wolf. That's the name it has in the damage tables that I found. Ooh, I even got that strat as well. Very nice. Using the updraft. Oh no, don't do that. Yeah, this is cycles and that's not very favourable. So, upcoming here is the worst fight in the game, in my opinion, the core. This is the laggiest part of the game once the action starts, and as I said way back when, lag translates to input drops, and I need to do a lot of fucking inputs here. I need to use rolling attacks as liberally as possible, and I also need to damage boost in the right places if I can. These crystals deal 1 heart of damage every time I take damage on them, whereas the yellow rings on the outside only deal 1/2 a heart. That was a really good fight though. Wow. So each of those crystals have 31 HP, which means the fastest way to kill them on average is to deal 1 rocket boost to each of them as the fight starts, and then 5 rolling attacks each once they come around again. Again, a rocket boost is 6 and a rolling attack is 5. So 31 minus 6 for 25, and then 5 rolling attacks per crystal. And that went really favorably. It cannot really be overstated just how dangerous that fight is. So now a quick ascent through here, and we come up to the final boss. This is a much more favorable shot at the final boss than I had in my last run, because I actually have full health this time. This guy has a lot of random attacks. There's not really much way to describe this other than I'm going to be using the sword a lot, because it's dangerous to use rocket boosts against this guy, and he has 126 HP. And time is when he is destroyed, when he explodes, so I'm just going to call time as I see it. So sometimes I'm not going to be able to avoid taking damage in this fight. If I can't, then I can at least deal 2 rolling attacks in the time that I have iframes. Time! I actually want to know what the time of the run was now, because that run was extremely good. I'm watching the timer and, oh my god, you have no idea how close. Was that a 1915? That was 1 second behind my PB slash world record. Oh my god, that was the best run I've ever performed in a live setting.
Yep, that looked like a 1917.
That... time is when the final boss explodes. I watched it back on the stream. That was a 1915. That was 1 second off my PB slash world record.
Wow, that's...
That was a phenomenally good run. It's... Oh, I can't really laud enough as well how hard this game is to play consistently as well. Like, anyone... Like, you can try to do runs of this game, but the bosses are so random and the fights are so dangerous that... finishing runs on good pace is very difficult and very inconsistent, so that was just phenomenally good. I'm thinking to myself now, like, oh, if only I'd played this section better, but I can't think of any sections that were just outright bad, aside from the time that in Stage 2 I hit exhaustion stupidly. So if that hadn't happened, then that would have been world record by a second or two, but still, I'll take it, I'll certainly take it. That was a really, really good run.
Yeah, congrats.
Yeah, if I'm splooging all over the place, I apologize, because wow, that run was good.
Quite all right.
I believe next, am I just segueing into Rocket Knight?
Yeah, up next is you again with Rocket Knight.
Okay.
So I will get the stream set up.
Just tell me when I need to get the game up and I can do it immediately.